What is up, everyone? Everyone is doing okay. Jello, come on in, come on in. It is a hot one here in Oklahoma. Done did my little jog for the day, so feeling great, looking lovely. Gonna wait a little bit. I think we're still waiting on Shug. Get your favorite beverage ready. Hopefully water or some Pedialyte. I'm excited today. Well, as always, I'm going to leave it open for our guests to ask questions, and we will let our guests answer as we go along. So if y'all have any questions as we get to going, type them in the comment section, and we will get them read for you. Hopefully everyone had a good weekend. I had a great weekend. I went to a stomp dance in Henrietta, Oklahoma, and it was one of the best stomp dances I've been to in a long time. And I actually didn't dance, I just sat there and enjoyed and spectated, and it was just one great dance. There were so many people, so many other dance grounds there, and it was one for the books. Give Miss Lady Shug Shug a little bit more time. She is getting ready. Landa, yell at her. Tell her, hurry up. And Shawnee, to say hurry up, we say hoppachi. So hoppachi, Lady Shug. Time is a ticking. I'm going to go ahead and get our intro out of the way while we are here. Hello, hello. Come on in. All right, everyone, this is another Skoden Talks with the Homies. Today we are having Skoden Talks with the Queens, with the ladies that created the LaLa Land Back Tour. We have Landa Lakes and Lady Shooks with us today. IP3 is an organization that provides nonviolent direction, action, training, campaign strategy, and community organizing tools to support Indigenous communities taking action in defense of their homelands. IP3 is currently taking community training requests and will be offering our annual Action Camp training for Indigenous organizers and activists later this year. For more information, contact info at ip3action.org. All right, let's see if we can get... Miss Lady Shug as we go. Right. There she is. Miss Chickasaw, Miss Montana, Two Spirits herself. How is she?
I'm doing great. A little tired, but a little great. We just celebrated our 19th anniversary of the Brush Harbor Girls, which is the Indigenous drag troupe here in San Francisco.
Congratulations. So,
yesterday, it was nice.
And how many girls are there in the Brush Harbor Girls?
Altogether, the amount of Brush Harbor Girls, there is a core group of 7 altogether. Really, when we first started, you know, there's sort of like a lot of people that really came together at that time. But over time, like, it's really a core group of about 7 performers. But last night, we brought in all these new people. It was really cool. Very young people.
Thank you, Juan. I think she was talking to, or he was talking to you, Landa, looking like a hot auntie over there.
Well, you're actually physically hot auntie today.
Yes. Oh, my gosh. These Oklahoma weather has been just... out to get us.
Yeah, Mike.
And if it's not hot, our rainstorms here lately have been like kind of devastating, like high winds and just a lot of rain. Our rains are like crazy right now. The waters are up, and supposed to go on a floating trip this weekend, and hopefully it don't get canceled because the high waters. Auntie's not trying to roll down the river.
Well, my mom's telling me that you know, her air conditioner has been going like full blast, you know, and she said that even at nighttime, there's no real relief. It's still like super hot at night too. And it made me think of like when I was a kid in Oklahoma and it'd be like 120 and something degrees. And I had no problem playing outside. Oh, and nowadays about it and I'm like, I don't even think I would want to play indoors.
Well, luckily, like, it's been so weird because usually, like, in past summers, if it's been a hot day, it's been a hot night. But luckily, as soon as the sun goes down, it cools down a lot. And then stomp dancing too, I've noticed right around like 2 or 3, the dew falls a little early and then it gets like cold. And then right back at 8, 9 o'clock, it is back to smolding hot. So there she is, Miss Shug Shug. Oh, she's got her little bob on today.
No, this is my real hair. What are you talking about?
Oh. I like a good, what you call it? A good 5-cent wig. How is she though? How is the weather?
It's okay. It's dry. It's hot.
Auntie is drinking Pedialyte today. This weather has been dehydrating me. So, Landa is going to be giving up her crown in less than a month. Would you like to tell them about your royalty status?
Sure. So I'm the current reigning Miss Montana Two-Spirit, and I got the crown last year. Actually, it's funny because, you know, I didn't compete for the crown. I didn't really compete for the crown. Because usually I MC the show. I'm usually when I'm in Montana, I usually MC the show. Sometimes I'm joined with Spirit Wildcat. Sometimes it's just me, but, I usually MC the show, but at the powwow, we have a mini powwow there and at the Montana Two Spirit Gathering. So when they were coming in, they were like, this year we're going, our Miss Montana Two Spirit is going to be Landa Lakes. And I was like, what? And I was like, I was sitting there and I had like my bangs on and I'm like, oh my God, I had to put this crown on. So I changed my bangs with the outgoing, and as she took off the crown, I put the little bangs on her and I set the new, the crown on my head.
She goes, I don't need these anymore. I've got a crown now. And what dates is the Montana Two Spirit gathering?
It's always in August, and this year it's going to be on August 16th. Through the 19th, and I'm looking forward to it. It'll be fun. I'm hoping to do like a Chickasaw dinner, so I'll be serving like banaha and pashofa and some of those traditional foods. And if people are wondering, yes, it's very bland. It's very bland food. We have this thing where, you know, it's what we call hoppy adjacent. Because hoppy is salt, and everything goes great with salt. And back in the day, what people used to do was they would take like hot grease and pour it over like the banaha or the pashka or the bread. And they don't really do that anymore because they're healthier.
We're trying
to be healthier. But some people still do.
So as most of you know, today we're going to talk with our creators at the LaLa Land Back Tour. Would y'all like to tell us how y'all had got that name and how it all came about?
Sure. Well, you know, I'm Landa Lakes, and of course, it's Lady Shug. So we just took the first parts of our name, which is La and La, back together. So it's the LaLa Land Back Tour. And it's funny because me and Lady Shug, before we actually met in person, we met some years ago on a telephone call with Native America Calling, and they were asking us about what it means to be Indigenous drag queens in the Indigenous community.
Awesome. And most of you know, we started this, what, in Denver? Or had y'all?
No, I think it's been before that, we're not fully 100% on tour yet. We're trying to get funding for it, but able to create spaces. So basically, the LaLa Land Back Tour is why we add Land Back Tour is because us as queer artists, this is our time to take these lands back and hold space and show our artistry. So that's why LaLa Land Back Tour came about. Because me and Sister Landa were working, we were working constantly together, creating shows. So I looked at her and I was like, girl, we should just take this on the road. And just the chemistry that her and I have, and just the love and passion we have for drag, and then just being Indigenous, is you can't get it anywhere else. And it was just a perfect fit. So now we just want to invade these spaces and go on a world tour. And let people know that there are amazing drag, trans, two-spirit, Indigenous artistry that are out there, and then are always overlooked or always not invited to spaces. So,
that's one of the things that we really wanted to concentrate on too, is like going into these spaces and finding local Indigenous artists to join us on stage, because sometimes it's hard out there. It's hard to get a booking. And it's hard to remain consistently in that booking, because there's lots of places that really don't want to pay you. And they're like, oh, it's your first time. Come and perform for tips. And that only works for so long. Really, you have to have like a good booking to really, really go forward. And so part of our tour is, as we go back, we spotlight the Indigenous artists in that area, as well as spotlighting just Indigenous talent that's all over Turtle Island.
And if y'all haven't got a chance to see the show, Lady Shug and Landa both have a couple of numbers that are like really, really powerful. One I wanted to highlight is your Red Hand performance. How did you come about with that concept?
So I was asked to do an original song. So that's an original song. The artist, she's a Diné person. Her name is Sage Bond. She's an amazing, amazing artist. And I believe she is a teacher in one of the tribal colleges here on my territory. So she sang that song or created that song for me. And so I did it as a duet originally with one of my radical friends that does a lot of work for unsheltered relatives and Indigenous resistance. We were doing a festival in Flagstaff, Arizona, where we were basically highlighting Latin culture and Indigenous culture and intertwining them both. And so the creator, his name is Clee Benali, he asked me, he's like, I want to have a drag artist, and of course I want to have you. And so that's how that song got created. It's talking about missing and murdered Indigenous relatives. And it was so crazy for me because it was so out of my comfort zone, because it's very dark, it's very grungy. And I've never done something like that. But as soon as I did it, and to actually have the actual artist, in the stage, watching me perform it, I have never experienced that either. Because, you know, majority of the time when we lip sync these songs, we never get to see the artist. So to actually see the actual person singing it, that I'm lip syncing it, and I got the approval from them was so, so amazing. And so after that, she gifted me that song, and she created that song for me to only sing it and not have it as a duet. Because originally it was a duet, but she redid it, she re-sang it, and gave me the track of just her singing by myself. And I got the whole outfit made, and it's something that needs to be talked about, and I can't wait to share it with the world.
It's definitely something to see. I got to see it for the first time in Montana, and I was blown away. She's got her feather, she's got the outfit, she's got her red hands, and it's just a very powerful piece. And I was just kind of like, oh my gosh, sister, yes, they need to see this. And anytime she's on the mic, she is saying, happy gay pride, Land Back. And these people, they're just kind of like, what'd she say? And then when she says it again, they're just kind of like, oh, yeah. Like, so it's awakening them. And it's good to hear, because most of the time these gay prides are ran by mainly white queens, or sometimes our black queens too, but it's never us. And so to be able to be in those spaces and take up spaces and have them chant back stuff that we've been trying to work so hard, it's so nice to hear. And we also have Landa. Landa has a piece she created to talk about the boarding schools. Would you like to talk about that?
Sure. You know, I have this piece called Paper Dolls, which is all about boarding schools. Really, it goes further back than that. It goes basically to the Civilization Act that was enacted by Congress, which was pretty much when Congress sort of started taking this parental role with Indigenous people, and suddenly, like, they're the big parent of us all. And byproducts of that is, like, the whole assimilation and the boarding school experience. And my tribe specifically has a really long history with boarding schools, even before the Assimilation Act, because my tribe has been creating these boarding schools primarily in connection with churches, like long before they started the assimilation process. And so, like, in my family, when I look back at my family, you know, my great-grandfather, my grandmother, my father, my siblings, myself, we've all been to boarding school. We've all had the boarding school experience, the Indian boarding school experience. And, you know, of course, during my father's generation, things had started changing, and they started giving it back to the tribes. But it's already in this pattern where, unfortunately, it sort of sets you up to where you think that, well, if the kids aren't doing what I tell them to do, I'll just send them to boarding school. I'll just send them to this Indian boarding school. And suddenly it becomes sort of like this connection. And it was interesting. I saw this interview where this woman was talking, and she had sent all of her children to Indian boarding school. And they asked her if she felt like her experience in boarding school was good. And she said, no, it was horrible. And she said, well, what do you think your children's experience was? And she cried a hospital, and she said it was horrible. So they already know that they're sending them off to like this to this place that's pretty regulated and everything. I will say this, my boarding school experience did prepare me for the military. When I went into the military, I was set. I was like, oh yeah, this is just like boarding school. This is fine. So I don't know. So my piece is about boarding school. My piece is, you know, about all the children that have been found in these unmarked graves. And I do that with a little storytelling where I pull in a lot of little things from Southeastern culture to bring it in. I don't know if people are very familiar with like this thing that we have back home, and they're called death houses. And so in the past, I guess many years ago, they used to build these houses on mounds, and then they would have like then they would burn them down and they would do a burial each time. And then when the Trail of Tears happened and they were crossing over, what they did instead of having like regular death houses is they would build these little small death houses over the graves. And so that's heavily featured into the performance of that, because those are actually death houses. They can sort of also look like boarding schools, but really they're death houses. And if you're Southeastern, you'll recognize it. But if you're not, then you'll think that it's a boarding school. So it works both ways, really. And so it's just the finding of like all those 215 children that started the whole movement to suddenly go and find all these children in unmarked graves.
It's a very powerful piece. I keep saying feast. It's not feast, it's a piece. But I think the first time I saw it was when y'all had the powwow in Arkansas, and what a powerful message you're sending to all of them. I applauded and cried, and I was like, oh my gosh, this is such a strong piece, because I think all of us, we've all been touched and been around boarding schools. And even with my family, my dad's mom and dad, that's how they met, in boarding school. Growing up, they weren't brought up. I'm having some feedback. Let me see. Is it good? I think we're good now. Okay. So growing up, though, with my father's side that was grown up in the boarding schools, there's no sense of family. There's no sense of traditions. And so it's very broken. And I'm affected by it, and I don't really know the language on that side. I don't know the culture. And so to see that piece being brought out to the front stage, especially in our communities, it is very important, because it shows a side of where we're coming from. And a lot of the times too, the Native American communities are very shy. They don't know how to interact with the gay communities or be out in the front. And so it's nice for us to be out there and be shown and be featured and to be on tour. The first time I got to work with these two, we were in Denver. And would y'all like to talk about the name of that show that we had in Denver?
Oh yeah, that was Wagon. That was Wagon. And you know, we were sort of together as the advisors, how we were going to do this. And so they really allowed us a lot of leeway in who exactly we wanted to like bring in and do our performances. So that's sort of how it happened. Like we couldn't decide on location, and my first thought was like, let's do Oklahoma. and so a few places, and we were like, Oh, Seattle, San Francisco. Hold on, ladies, we're getting a lot of feedback from you.
Let's see. Hold on. See if I can't help with it. Ladieship, can we exit you and then have you come back?
Come back.
Sorry, darling. Sorry, this is our first time actually having all three people in their lives. So, Are you able to back out yourself? Because I can't get you out. I can't kick you. Now she's just got the circle going.
She's on that red as Wi-Fi. So.
Oh, it's there's always one, I'm telling you.
ResNet.
And it's usually the Navajo. Just kidding. Now I can't get, oh, there we go. Okay. Let's see if we can't get her back. Well, no, I don't see her. We lost her. But if you could go ahead and explain. Well,
you know, they gave us a lot of leeway in who to bring in and how we wanted to structure the show. And so we were able to sort of structure the show after, like, you know, after, like, a lot of things that I do. Like that I've done, like, with the Brush Arbor Girls for years and everything. And that is, you know, we bring someone on, we would talk to them afterwards, you know. It was all about community. And one of the beautiful things is that when you look out onto the audience and you see so many of your own people out there, when you see brown faces, tan faces, you know, it's very different. It's very different. And you can feel it. You can feel the vibe different. You can feel, like, this connection of community, you know, and it's not about necessarily how the performer looks on stage, because they already feel, like, this connection to you. So it was a really sweet, sweet thing.
And the name of the show was Burn the Wagon. And when it got explained to me, I was kind of like, what? Because, like, growing up here in Oklahoma, especially, like, when they would call us burning our wagon burners, it was supposed to be derogatory and make fun of us and kind of just shame us, basically. And that was basically the Caucasian community coming at us like that. And then they were like, when they explained that to me, they was like, we're trying to reclaim that. Because, like, if you really think about it, we were burning wagons to get them off of our land to chase them away. And I was like, oh. And so, of course, when we started publicizing the name of it, everybody's kind of like, what? And it was, especially here in Oklahoma, it was rubbing people a little wrong. And then after I explained it, they were like, okay. They's like, as long as you're safe, as long as there's not going to be anybody kind of trying to create any trouble. And I was like, I trust my sisters. Like, I was like, I'm pretty sure everybody knows how to fight. So...
Yes, yeah. We really wanted to reclaim that. We wanted to reclaim that name and everything. You know, I think that one of the misconceptions that America really has about, like, terms like that, wagon burner, supposed to be offensive and everything else. When you think about it, you know, today people are always, like, stocking up their guns and saying, no immigrants. Well, think about the Native community. Do you think that we necessarily were like, oh yeah, sure, come across our land. Take as many animals as you want while you're going through that we used to feed our families. Yeah, go ahead. So crazy. Yes, sooner.
Can you hear me okay?
Yes, now we can hear you okay.
I also think it was kind of funny that we were doing it at Charlie's. If people don't know, Charlie's is like a Western bar, and for it to be called Wagon Burners, especially Charlie's being predominantly gay, cis, white boys, and us Indigenous girls burning that down, was kind of epic.
that show, from my experience and from my eyes, was totally epic. And to see, that was the first time in my lifetime that I actually seen the whole crowd was brown people, and it just Indigenous people from all over. And there was people that flew in from everywhere to come see this show. And so it was something that needed to be done. It was to set precedents. And I cried after I got off the stage the first time. I had to take it in because I was like, wow. I was like, I have never experienced this. And just have that Indigenous energy given back to us, it made us want to perform even more. And I loved that. My adrenaline was up the whole night. And I was like, this is so beautiful. And I was so thankful for that opportunity. And when we got to perform in the Smithsonian this summer, I felt that energy too, because we still had a lot of people fly into New York just to come see that show. Is there anything that y'all would like to talk about during y'all's experience with either one of the trips?
Go ahead, sister.
I was going to pick up because I've been talking a lot.
You want the good stuff or the bad stuff too?
The good, the bad, and the evil.
No, to be honest, it's been beautiful to be put in these spaces, but also demand these spaces. To actually be the first drag show to perform there at the Smithsonian was another milestone for all of us. I just feel like this tour and something like this is well needed just in spaces, not just in queer communities, but just, you know, even in our tribal lands. Like, we need to bring drag back to our own territories that we were forced onto. That's one of my goals, continuing this tour, because I see longevity. I see it not just happening this year or last year. I see it happening, you know, in the next 5 to 10 years. Hey, we might possibly even go international and go, you know, overseas. Londa's looking at me like, you're crazy, girl. that's how much passion and drive I see behind this tour within myself. I don't take it for granted. I'm thankful for all these people to include us and have spaces like the Smithsonian, like big groups like Illuminative, but we need more. It doesn't just need to happen once a year or during Pride season or during Native American Heritage Month. It needs to happen year round. I think if we see more people like us in the forefront of our tribe, of our own queer community, I think it's going to change people's lives. Even not only our young adults and youth, but also our elders. Because sometimes I have a few experiences from some of my elders saying that I could never be out and proud like you are, especially where you came from and doing what you do. So I thank you. So even from our elders, they give thanks to us. So, you know, these spaces that we were invited to, they were beautiful, but I feel like it needs to happen more often, not just once a year.
When Nick said we need to be at Darcel's in Portland, I mean, let's get it together. I would love to visit Portland.
I don't want to go to Darcel's, not that marathon drag show. No, thank you. if a drag show is running longer than 2 hours, no.
we need to eat.
I think that one they're talking about, they did like they now have the Guinness World Record for having the longest drag show. I think that's what they're talking about.
Well, congratulations. Yeah, like, yeah. I want to see it. It's too long. We used to have marathon drag shows out here, fundraisers, and, you know, they would schedule people, but it was just so long. It was just so long, and, you know, it's a lot after a while, and finally you're just sort of like, okay, I'm done. I don't want to do drag for a while.
Usually after Gay Pride, I'm prided out, like, leave me alone. It's my birthday. Let Auntie be.
Yes.
So, alongside of what's going on with us, the whole world is changing. There's a lot of political stuff going on. Is there anything changing in your hometowns with the laws, with the children and the drag shows and the drag story hours? Is there anything that is affecting you personally, or is it still the same?
Well, let me just say something on that. You know, in Oklahoma specifically, you know, we don't have to necessarily conform to exactly what Oklahoma says, because, you know, we have our own like reservation, especially the Chickasaw, Choctaw, Cherokee. You know, we all have, and Creek, we all have like our own sort of like reserve now that it's been sort of like reiterated in the courts and everything. So if we wanted to have this, we could. However, at the same time, you have to understand that in Oklahoma, you know, we have a lot of Christians and everything else. So I think that you're not really seeing a lot of things change. And also, what's more is, especially within our tribes, we don't really have freedom of press. People think that we do, but we don't. So in our tribal papers and everything else, you're getting fed only what they're going to tell you. So a lot of times when Indigenous queer people are featured, they skip over the queer part, even though that's a huge part of their identity. And a lot of times they'll still skip over it. And so I was very excited this year in Ada, Oklahoma. Ada, which is sort of like the seat of the Chickasaw Nation. It's not our capital. Our capital is Tishomingo, but it's the seat of our tribal enterprises. And in Ada, Oklahoma, they had their first pride. And I was very excited about that. I know some Chickasaws that went to that, and I thought that that was like the coolest thing. But then in my head, I was also thinking, well, the Chickasaw Nation didn't report anything about it. So it's not in our tribal paper. The Chickasaw Nation didn't support it in any way. So, and it's like, these are the things that run through my head is like, there's so much that my tribe could still be doing to include all people. And they don't, they still don't. So it's still gonna be a continual push that we have to do. And you know, I'm in that book, not unfortunately, but you know that book, 565, the book by Martika Wilbur? I'm in that book, but in the quotes that I have in there, oh my gosh, I started to dig into the tribe about that. And it's not pretty, but it's a stark reality of where we are right now, is that can't keep pushing us under the rug. Eventually we're gonna come out. And if you're a drag queen, you're gonna come out very colorful too.
Very much so. And also here in Oklahoma, we do have our sovereignty. We do have our sovereignty nations, and I wish the tribes would follow us and be one with us and support us and allow us to do that. And which, I mean, we probably could if we tried a little bit harder, but we have not felt that love yet. But also too, with our sovereignty, it is getting challenged right now with our governor. He is totally against the drag queens. He's totally against drag story hours. And not only that, he is trying to take sovereignty away from our tribal, the tribes here. And so everything's getting challenged right here in my state alone. And so it's a little scary, but here in my hometown, we've been having the drag shows. I'm here in Norman, Oklahoma, around the University of Oklahoma. And we work very closely with the police here. And they've backed us up, and they told us if these laws do go into effect, it is by county to decide if they're going to withhold those laws. And they have told us that they are going to stand in solidarity with us and support us and not hold those laws against us. So I'm hoping that stays true, because that's where my hometown is, and that's where I do drag. And we have some great entertainers here, and especially some of the students, and they work very close with the kids here, and they do story hour. And I think it would be more devastating if they did hold those laws to where they're trying to charge us and keep us in jail and fine us to the max. So it's really crazy.
I know for my territory, the Diné tribe, we do have a new tribal president, and we have new council members. So we'll see what they do. Every year they always use the gay agenda, but I have yet to see, you know, the Marriage Equality Act happen on my territory, and even hate law crimes. And even discrimination if you're queer and work for the tribe. We're still not protected. And so we'll see what happens this year. I mean, we'll see, because every year they always make promises, but it never happens. They do have a pride here. It's called Diné Pride. They claim to be the largest Indigenous pride on the U.S. So I don't know. I didn't give that name. but they were, I was a part of it. I was the first drag queen to perform for that about 2018.
I thought you was going to say 20 years ago. Like,
wow.
Well, I've been doing drag shows on my territory, even when I wasn't invited, for like quite some time now.
How many years ago, doll?
Bitch, don't. No, but to be honest, about 6 years, for like the past 6 years.
Oh.
Yeah. That was like one of my highlights, though, is because I was doing a show because they wouldn't let us do a drag show during a tribal fair. And so it took about 3 years. And then finally in 2019, right before the pandemic, Tuba City, Arizona, for Western Navajo Nation Fair in Tuba City, they had the first ever tribal indigenous drag show. And we actually were the headliners or the opening act for Snow the Product. And that was so beautiful to see. And if you look it up on YouTube, you can see the whole show. It's called Western Navajo Nation Fair at Tuba City. And that was the first time I actually felt seen from my own people, is because we were invited to a tribal fair, finally. And then the pandemic happened. And then I found Sister Landa and we went on tour. So I haven't been able to go back.
She's booked and blessed. She's taken her mutton on the road.
I don't know who confused you that you think that I like that, bitch. I eat lamb, not mutton. I don't eat old broads like you, sister.
Oh, well, Lady Shug, it was nice having you on. Just so is there anything coming up in the works with the LaLa Land or with y'all personally?
I think as far as the tour, we're currently working on some fall dates. So we have nothing to announce. It's just to be announced right now. So we're just looking for venues, sponsors. And we're also just trying to find funding. People don't realize that it takes a lot of money to do a lot of traveling, especially for some of us that don't live in the bigger cities. It's harder for us to travel, you know, from these smaller airports, you know, to these bigger venues. No shade to my sister Landa, but so it takes a lot of money to do this, and but it needs to happen. So if anybody's out there that they know a venue or they know a sponsor, or even if they just want to send a little coin to us three, we'll gladly take it, because we'll put it back into our arch, and hopefully we'll come to a city or a reservation near you.
Yeah, I think the next big thing for us, like, will probably be in November. You know, the day after Thanksgiving is American Indian Heritage Day, and so we're going to have here, like, the largest drag club in the United States is right here in San Francisco. It's called Oasis, and we're going to be having a show there that day, and so it's going to be a very, I think it's going to be a very cool show. We're going to have it filmed, and I think it'll be great. So that's the next thing coming up. I don't want to say too much about it because it's still in the works and it's still being planned. And so when it happens, it'll be cool.
Yeah. I think just to follow us three on social media and just follow us, and you guys will get updates as soon as we get updates. Unfortunately, we're not all by agents, or we're not millionaires yet. So all the stuff that we do in all these shows are from, I think someone called me, sorry. Can you still hear me?
Yes. Okay.
We're all self-funded, and we all do our own bookings and stuff like that. So it takes a little bit longer for us, but eventually we'll get there, and we'll have somebody do it all for us, and we'll give you a whole year's date of all of where you can see us at.
Yeah, are we going to be back in Oklahoma?
I was going to go ahead and give a little bit of a spoiler. So for Native American Month and Day, we are something in the works here at the University of Oklahoma, where Landa is the alumni. We're going to have a panel talking to our Two-Spirit panel, talking to the people, and then we are going to have a drag show in that evening. And I believe the date is October 9th. So everything's in the works. As soon as I get a flyer out, we will have that posted. But that is something in the works for Oklahoma. I'm excited to announce that and have my sisters here with me. And we will have a little bit of the local girls here with the show, too. So be sure to follow us. I'm I'm excited to bring it to Oklahoma. They've been wanting it. They've been seeing me everywhere. So they're like, when are we going to have an Oklahoma version? So here's your chance, Oklahoma.
Yeah, and I think I'm going to be in Oklahoma for a while during that time. I'm going to come out, and then I'm going to just, like, stay. for almost the whole month.
So that'll be the best time, because the weather will definitely cool off. Oh, my goodness. It is too hot here. We don't want Lady Shug to melt away. Well, we are coming to the end of our little chat here. Is there anything y'all would like to plug or anything we can do to uplift your work or help with the tour?
Go ahead.
Lady Shug also does have merch too. So how can we get some Lady Shug merch? And she does some awesome bead work. She does some the trans gays, all of it. Whatever you like, she will do for you.
Yeah, I would slide into my DMs if you want some merch or some beaded work. I do mutual aid here. So if you just look up hashtag Shug Challenge, the mutual aid here I do is for unsheltered relatives, including our Indigenous elders that live far and deep in our territory on our reservation, as well as our trans youth. So it's just a big complex of just helping the people that are forgotten most of the time. So look up Shug Challenge. I always do that year round. I always take donations, whether it's a dollar, whether it's a sleeping bag, I will take it and give it to one of our Indigenous relatives. But also I think just highlighting us, like, it doesn't always have to be a showtime. I think I just challenge you guys to uplift an Indigenous artist. That's not necessarily needs to be drag, but make sure they're queer or trans. Highlight them, or go to your local community center, or go to your local pride organization, or go to a local museum and tell them that we want to bring the LaLa Land Back tour to our town, or you should include more Indigenous drag artistry to our pride function. Like, if you do that, it helps us in the long run. So that's all I got to say. And I hope to see all y'all on the LaLa Land Back tour.
Yes. So on my side, if you want to get my t-shirt or something, you can always go to my website. It's pashofa.com. Pashofa is our national dish, and that's pashofa.com. You can find out that. But if you also want to support our Two-Spirit Powwow out here, we're going on our 13th year of the Two-Spirit Powwow. It was like the first and largest public Two-Spirit Powwow in the world. And it continues to bring in like around 5,000 people each year. So if you want to support us in our work, it's all pretty much grassroots. So we don't have any like humongous funders coming in. We don't have casinos supporting it. We work hard to present it for our community. And that happens every February. So if you want to support that, you can always go to Baits. That's BAAITS.org. That's Baits.org. And you can find our donation link and go ahead and support that. It's a beautiful thing. If you've never been to the powwow, please come out and join us. It's we have like a huge native market, as well as like more or less an Oklahoma style powwow here in California. So it's lots of fun, and it's a good cultural experience if you've never really experienced a lot of that, or if you are Two-Spirit and you want to come out into the circle for the first time, the dancing circle, and dance a style that you don't normally dance to start going into the circle and other powwows, you can do that too.
It is a very non-gender powwow. If you've never been, it is something to experience. I've gotten to go twice, once as Miss International Two-Spirit, and then I was also a head dancer there, and both times, so much love, so much energy, and there's so many good Two-Spirit royalty and stars that you've seen on all the web, and then you finally get to see them all in one spaces. The laughs, the cackles, it is everything. And then it's just in a beautiful setting too. Like, you can see the Alcatraz, and just right there by the water, it's just beautiful. But Landa, I would like to say congratulations on your reign this year. You have represented beautifully. And thank you for showing a little bit of Oklahoma around US and everywhere, all your travels, and thank you for being such a great representative.
Thank you. It's been fun.
And like,
I've enjoyed.
I'm telling you, and then hopefully we can just throw that crown right on Lady Shug. Don't wear your bangs, girl.
I try to wear my. I forgot this one don't have bangs. I was trying to wear my Landa bangs.
You should have just cut some on real quick.
This is human hair, girl.
Well, human hair, you can do a human haircut. But Lady Shug, thank you also for being here on the show, and thank you for always showing so much love as a sister. You have been so supportive and guiding. I've never been on anything like this before, and you've kind of shown me the ropes being on tour with you, and just thank you for always being a sister and checking on me, and thank you all for inviting this Shawnee doll to be on the LaLa Land Back tour, and hopefully we make more memories together and keep this going. So with that, everyone, we are, oh, and there's her merch, her t-shirt. You can make lovely tank tops, dish rags, and pot holders out of them. I save them for a day when I run out of toilet paper. Just kidding. Yes. They're reusable. Just throw them in the washer. But thank you all for joining us on Skoden Talks with the Homies. Catch us again next month for another episode. I thank you, ladies, so much for joining me, and I hope y'all have a wonderful and blessed day.
Thank you.
All right, bye-bye. Thank you.